We are happy to have with us former CIA Director John Brennan, who is now an NBC News Senior National Security and Intelligence Analyst. Director Brennan, it's really good to have you on this morning. You have been increasingly vocal against President Trump. On February 20th, the president tweeted, "I have been much tougher on Russia than Obama. Just look at the facts. Total fake news." And you replied, "It never ceases to amaze me how successful you have been making yourself so small, petty, and banal with your tweets. Your insecurity is well deserved, as is your concern over Russia investigation. Thomas Paine was right when he said, these are the times that try men's souls." Earlier this month, Trump tweeted about the loss of American jobs from President H.W. Bush till now, stating it was a bad result. It was a result of bad policies and leadership. You countered with, "You show an amazing, albeit unsurprising, ignorance of how technology, automation, and the attendant evolution of economics and societies have transformed the world. Your simple-minded policies, imposition of tariffs, have the potential to seriously damage our future prosperity." And just last Saturday, Trump tweeted about the firing of Andrew McCabe, writing in part, "Sanctimonious James Comey was his boss and made McCabe look like a choir boy. He knew all about the lies and corruption going on at the highest levels of the FBI." And you replied, "When the full extent of your venality, moral turpitude, and political corruption becomes known, you will take your rightful place as a disgraced demagogue in the dustbin of history. You may scapegoat Andy McCabe, but you will not destroy America. America will triumph over you." Is America being tried at this point, especially in terms of its place in the world? Is this president letting our country down?
Well, I think the president has shown a lack of understanding of international affairs, as well as a real ignorance of what it takes to be president of the United States. And that's what prompted my tweets. He is mean-spirited. He is dishonest. He has shown a lack of integrity. And he has continued to, I think, demean the office of the presidency. And so I've decided to put my silence aside and to speak up and speak out, because I do think our future is in jeopardy while Mr. Trump continues his antics.
Let me follow up on that. Are we on the verge of a constitutional crisis?
Well, I think many of the senators and members of Congress have said that if Trump decides to sack Mueller, that we are going to be in a constitutional crisis. And I have great confidence in Bob Mueller. He is a tremendous American, and he is going to get to the bottom of this investigation. But if Mr. Trump, who I think is increasingly feeling the pressure and feeling very anxious and nervous about what's going on, if he decides to remove Bob Mueller, I do think then we're going to be at that crisis point.
Mr. Director, you just said our future is in jeopardy. That's a chilling statement from someone who knows the things you know about the way our government works and what's happening around the world. What do you mean specifically by that?
Well, I think he's mishandled so many matters. Just look at what happened yesterday with his call to Vladimir Putin. Vladimir Putin was the person who authorized the interference in our election. Vladimir Putin almost certainly was involved in directing the poisoning of an individual on British soil. And to congratulate him and to treat him so nicely while he treats Americans with such disdain, I think it just demonstrates that he looks at the world through a prism of what is going to help and protect Donald Trump. That is not what presidents are supposed to do. I worked for six presidents. I didn't agree with some of their policies, but all of them were trying to do what they thought was best for the United States. That's not Mr. Trump. He is self-absorbed, and he is trying to just promote his own interests and protect his flanks.
Is it a war with North Korea that concerns you? In other words, when you say our future is in jeopardy, what long-term damage can happen to the country because of one man?
Well, I don't know what he's going to do with North Korea. I mean, the fact that he, you know, opted to have a summit meeting with Kim Jong-un before really any preparation is being done, it shows his impetuousness, the fact that he is not, you know, looking at issues with the type of depth and sophistication that is needed. He totally ignored the briefing cards that were given to him for his call with Putin, when in caps it said, "Do not congratulate." So I think he's mishandling these things, and the United States plays a very important role around around the globe. And I don't know what Mr. Trump is going to do, but he is not somebody who's going to study these issues. He's not going to take his time to think about what's in the best interest of the United States. So I am concerned about our future and our national security.
What do you chalk it up to? Why won't the president confront Vladimir Putin? Why won't he read the cards and say the things that you say need to be said to Vladimir Putin? Do you believe he's somehow in debt to the president of Russia?
I think he's afraid of the president of Russia.
Why?
Well, I think one can speculate as to why, that the Russians may have something on him personally, that they could always roll out and make his life more difficult. Clearly, I think it's important for us to be able to improve relations with Russia. But the fact that he has had this fawning attitude toward Mr. Putin has not said anything negative about him. I think continues to say to me that he does have something to fear and something very serious to fear.
You believe Russia has something on him?
I believe that the Russians would not they would opt for things to do if they believe that it was in their interest. And the Russians, I think, have had long experience with Mr. Trump, and may have things that they could expose.
Something personal, perhaps?
Perhaps.
What does it tell you about the White House staff, the national security staff, their thoughts about the sitting president of the United States? When it's leaked within 2 hours, something so sensitive about a topic so sensitive as is yesterday?
Well, I think it reflects their frustration and probably also their disgust that the President of the United States, who is going to be talking to Mr. Putin, refuses to follow the advice of the Russian experts from the national security staff. That is something that I think they feel that what's the sense of doing their job if he's just going to countermand what it is that they are recommending. So the fact that somebody called the Washington Post and gave detailed information about it, I think it shows the level of frustration has reached fever pitch right now in the White House.
So yesterday, the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia was in Washington, D.C. What does this presidency, the way it's been conducted, do to our allies? Not just Saudi Arabia, ostensibly an ally, but France, Germany, Great Britain suffering through someone being poisoned, ostensibly by Russia, allegedly by Russia, on its own soil. Does the president of the United States today, does his word mean anything to our allies?
Well, they're asking themselves questions about, does this mean that the United States has changed from its fundamental position of being the leader of the free world? And can we trust anything that comes out of the mouth of the incumbent in the Oval Office? Because he has demonstrated that he changes his views, changes his position, changes his words. So I think there's a real sense of unsettlement around the globe among our partners and allies. I think it is playing into Mr. Putin's hands because the United States is not seen as that reliable partner and ally that's going to be supportive, particularly of our European partners. I think Angela Merkel and others are really scratching their heads trying to figure out exactly what can she count on the United States for these days, given that Mr. Trump is in the Oval Office.
I want to read a statement Senator John McCain responded to yesterday's development, saying an American president does not lead the free world by congratulating dictators on winning sham elections. And by doing so, with Vladimir Putin, President Trump insulted every Russian citizen who was denied the right to vote in a free and fair election to determine their country's future, including the countless Russian patriots who have risked so much to protest and resist Putin's regime. Very strong words from Senator McCain, Kati.
Yeah, Senator McCain is sick, but he is an ill and frail, but he is not holding back when it comes about speaking out against this president and what he sees as egregious behavior. John Brennan, I just wanted to ask you a couple of very quick questions. First of all, you just said you thought it was possible that the Russians had something on Donald Trump. You were director of the CIA until 2017. Is that speculation or are you talking with information?
No, I'm saying that perhaps the Russians have something, and that's why Mr. Trump is concerned. Mr. Trump knows better than any one of us whether or not the Russians may have something on him. So I think it's very difficult to try to explain his behavior and why he has taken and adopted this position vis-a-vis Vladimir Putin personally. And so one can, again, speculate that maybe there's something there.
You've worked for six American presidents, both Republican and Democrat. Have you ever spoken out in the way that you are doing now against one of your former bosses?
No. This is the second time that I've retired. The first time I didn't speak out at all. I said some things in terms of policies, but never about the person. And this is a very different person who inhabits the Oval Office. Again, he lacks integrity. He's dishonest. He's mean-spirited. And he is not taking into account what really needs to be done as far as the United States national security interests are concerned. So I am very concerned about the direction that we're heading in, and that's why I have chosen to speak out like other former intelligence officials. It's lamentable that we have to, but this isn't about politics. I'm not a Republican or a Democrat. This is about the future of our country, our national security, our future prosperity. And Mr. Trump, I think, is failing on so many fronts. And what I'm most frustrated about is that he has hoodwinked so many individuals who have legitimate concerns about their state right now in terms of economics, about their future employment prospects. He has hoodwinked them. And I used in one of my tweets the term charlatan. I think he is masterful when it comes to putting out messages that are deceptive and lead people to believe that he has solutions to very complicated problems. So those are the people I feel most badly about, the ones that have been misled by Mr. Trump.
We've heard, Mr. Director, from Dan Coats, head of DNI. We've heard from Admiral Mike Rogers that still today, knowing what we know about Russia's interference in the 2016 election, not enough is being done to counteract it from happening again, that it's ongoing and will happen in 2018 and again in 2020. In your assessment, why isn't more being done? If we've identified the problem, why aren't we going all out to fight it?
Well, that's a very good question, and I know the Senate Intelligence Committee has come out with some recommendations, and I'm interested in looking at them in detail. But this is a real challenge as far as dealing with the digital domain and the cyber environment. I think Russian interference in the 2016 election was very symptomatic of the vulnerabilities that exist, the opportunities for troublemaking there. I have long argued that there needs to be an independent commission to deal with the challenges in the cyber domain. Just like we had after the 9/11 attacks, we had a 9/11 commission that thoughtfully, over a period of time, looked at what we needed to do as a country. The cyber environment is much more challenging as an issue than counterterrorism. And yet we are still taking these these very limited steps right. In terms of what it is we need to do.
Why is that, though? I mean, if you know what you have to do, why aren't the full steps being taken?
Well, I think we have to ask our legislators. It really is up to Congress, in fact, to initiate an independent commission that is going to bring together the technologists, scientists, futurists, government officials, private sector. The digital domain is owned and operated 85% by the private sector. So it's not a government-imposed solution. It has to be an unprecedented partnership between the private and the public sectors. And also, I think there needs to be more of a national consensus about what the role of government is going to be in that environment. Right. What should the FBI, NSA, CIA be doing to monitor and to help to thwart the attacks and the assaults that are taking place there?
We're just looking at tweets from President Trump in the past 10 minutes with misspellings, and I'll try and read them. Special counsel is told to find crimes, whether crimes exist or not. I was opposed to the selection of Mueller to be special counsel. I still am opposed to it. I guess he's quoting somebody. Oh, he's quoting Alan Dershowitz. I think President Trump was right when he said there never should have been a special counsel appointed because there was no probable cause for believing there was any crime, collusion or otherwise, or obstruction of justice, so stated by Harvard Law professor Alan Dershowitz in a series of two tweets misspelled, including misspellings by President Trump. So, Mr. Director, with that in mind, tell us, you were talking about your worry about the vulnerabilities that exist, given that this president has such terrible character. Spell out for our viewers, if you could, with some examples of what you're most worried about, what might happen, especially given these latest tweets where he's really pushing back, and he's pushing back against Mueller by name.
Well, I think you have concerns on the international front as well as on the domestic front. On the international front, I'm hoping we're not going to see a wag-the-dog scenario whereby he's going to try to distract the attention here domestically and politically on him and engage in some type of international initiative that is going to really put our nation at risk. Military action against North Korea, maybe doing something vis-a-vis Iran, again, tearing up the Iranian nuclear agreement and provoking and pushing for some type of confrontation in the Gulf. on the domestic front, if he sacks Rod Rosenstein or Bob Mueller, I think that really is going to bring this country to the brink of crisis. And that's when I think the members of Congress, particularly Republicans in Congress, are going to step up and do what is necessary in order to protect this country. Thank goodness we have individuals like Senator John McCain, who's a national treasure, who will speak up forcefully when he sees that this country is being wronged and when he is very concerned about what Mr. Putin is going to do to take advantage of us. So whether it be with one of our adversaries, North Korea or Iran, whether it is going to be one of our partners and allies that is going to have less confidence in the United States and then start to move toward Russia and China, again hurting us on the international field, these are things that I think all of us should be worried about. And I do believe that there are individuals within the White House, the National Security staff, and also within the Congress that are looking at Mr. Trump, seeing that he's acting more and more like a cornered animal and lashing out in whatever way he can. And who knows what that cornered animal will do once they really see the threat to their survival.
Mr. Director, we've already had one assault, perhaps an act of war, against the United States by Russia on our electoral system. And you talked about the difficulty of dealing with cyber warfare. Do you think today we are less safe today in terms of cyber war against our electric grids, financial systems, than we were 2 or 3 years ago? Are we not paying enough attention?
Well, I think every day the individuals responsible for the security of those different types of infrastructure are doing their best to try to prevent all the intrusions and assaults that are taking place. But the fact that this country has such a wide array of critical infrastructure, there are tremendous opportunities for adversaries to get into the system, navigate, deploy malware, and maybe leave it there so that at some point they could activate it. So I think every day we have to be looking at how we can further strengthen these systems, because every day our adversaries are developing new techniques, new technologies, new ways to assault, whether it be critical infrastructure or other parts of our economic and political system. So it's hard for me to say right now whether or not we're less safe than we were before. I just think that there are more actors out there, and it's not just the nation states and security and intelligence services. It's these various companies that have the capabilities to do this.
Former CIA director and NBC News senior national security and intelligence analyst John Brennan, thank you so much for being here with us this morning.
Thank you.
And still ahead on Morning Joe, from the Foreign Relations Committee, Senator Chris Coons reacts to the president's latest overture to Russia and his latest tweets against Bob Mueller and what we just heard from the former CIA director. Plus, the top House Democrat on intelligence issue, Congressman Adam Schiff, joins the conversation.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories. And you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.